Allah rahman rahim. So last time we started to talk about chapter 3, and we talked about the communication. We talked about communication. System components. So we talked about sender, destination. We talked about the message source, which is the interface of the user to the network, and then the transmitter, and then the medium, and then the receiver, and we also talked about encoder and decoder. But there was a very important component, which is not a physical component, but it's actually very, very important, which is also considered as a logical component of any communication system, which it's actually a software, it's a procedure, and it controls all the procedure of communication. Does anyone know what that component is or what it's called? If you have, no, raise your hand first so that I can give you the permission to. No one raises hands, no raise of hands. The question is, we talked about the physical communication system components, including the message source, the transmitter, the medium, the receiver, and then the message destination and all of this. But we also kind of hinted and mentioned that there is a very important component. It's actually not a physical component. It's actually a logical component that controls the entire communication. Okay. So does anyone know what that is? It's a bit of a tricky question, yani. Abdurrahman, Taysir, Abdurrahman, Fadl. Message A? La. This is part of today's lecture. We'll talk about it. But this is, yani, it has been mentioned last time very quickly, yani. It's a tricky question, yani. So there is a logical component that controls the entire communication, which is what we call a protocol. Okay? The protocol is the logical procedure that controls the everything related to the communication end-to-end. So our example, our famous example, talks about two people, at least two people, trying to communicate their thoughts. Do you hear me? Okay, so two people are trying to communicate their thoughts to each other. So we said that we need to have a message source where we take the ideas from the sender. This is the sender, and then convert it to a well-structured message. And then this well-structured message needs to be converted, even compressed sometimes using the encoder, and then converted to a physical signal where it can be transferred over the medium. Okay, so this is the medium. Until it reaches the other side. So the receiver will take this physical signal and then will convert it back to well-structured message in order for the destination to consume these messages and then understand the thoughts that I'm trying to convey. So these are the physical communication system components, but one of the very critical components, actually it's considered the most important component, which works in the background and controls everything related to the communication, which is what we call a protocol. So a protocol is the technique or the software or the logical component that controls what we call the rules of communication. The rules of communication. Okay. It controls the rules of communication. So what are these rules of communication? So before any two people or any two or more people, they can communicate. They have to agree on certain rules. Somebody might tell me, when I talk to a person, I don't have to spend hours to agree on certain rules. But this happens implicitly. Abdurrahman, do you have any question? Okay, so these rules have to be agreed upon between the source and the destination before the communication happens. This is very important. For example, if the source starts to talk in Chinese and the destination does not understand any language other than Arabic, then yani, they will not be able to understand each other. If the source tries to speak very, very, very fast so that the destination is overwhelmed, again, the destination will not be able to consume these messages efficiently, in which case, again, the destination will not be able to understand what we're saying. So these rules are very, very important, and in many cases, it's agreed upon implicitly or explicitly. So we'll talk throughout the course how can we establish these rules of communication before communicating to each other. And sometimes they are, you know, established implicitly between the two parties before they can communicate. So these rules of communication are classified into three categories. Three categories. So what are these categories, Yashab? For those of you who watched the video, and they can give us some idea about these categories for the rules of communication. Fadal Abdurrahman. Okay. All right. Any other raise of hands? Sorry, for some reason, I don't know why. I don't know why it disappears. Wow. Okay. Oh, yes. Hani Jaffer, تفضل. No, I'm talking about the rules of communication. The rules of communication. The rules of communication. The three categories are for the rules of communication. Mahinullah. The message content. So there are some rules related to the message content itself. And then what? No, I'm talking about the rules. The rules. There's nothing physical here. We're talking about rules. It's something, yani, it's not physical. It's something logical, yani. These are rules that govern the communication. The protocol actually control all these rules. Uh-huh. So there is message content. So one category is related to the message content. One category is related to the message timing and order. Okay, the message timing and order. And the third category here is based on the message delivery options. So these rules are categorized in these three categories to describe the rules of communication. So when it comes to the message content, Abdurrahman, do you want to say something? انت على طول رافع ايدك ما شاء الله يعني. Okay. So with regards to the message content, we have two rules or two basic rules. One is what we call the message structure. The message structure needs to be agreed upon before we start communicating. Why? Again, imagine if we, if these two people, they started to talk in Arabic or Chinese, and both of them, they agree, okay, so so the content is going to be Arabic, okay? And then the source uses a not well-structured message. For example, I put the khabar before the mubtada. I put like the sentence with grammatical problems. In that case, the sentence is not going to be well structured. And in that case, again, the destination will not be able to understand what I'm saying. So the message structure needs to be agreed upon. I need to know that your sentence will be mostly, you know, mubtada and khabar, or fa'al, fa'al, maf'ul, or something like this. So I need to have well structured message in order to have efficient way of communication. Number two, okay, number two is what we call the message size. The message size, okay? So we also have to agree on the message size. I cannot just have a message of 3 gigabytes being sent to you. In that case, you will not be able to consume that message, at least in one shot, okay? Like, just imagine that I talk to the entire class for 2 hours nonstop without really giving you the chance to say anything or to acknowledge whether you understand what I'm saying or not or something like this. So the message size has to be limited. So we have to agree on a message size. So those are the two rules that we have to agree upon in order to make sure that the communication is efficient. For message timing and order, that's even more important. Here, we don't have to arrange for the content of the message or the structure of the message. What we need to worry about in this category is how fast we send the message and what is the order, who will send the message when. So in this category, we have three different rules. One is what we call flow control. So the flow control is a very, very important concept that controls the speed of transmission from the source to the destination. Okay, so by flow control, we mean that we need to control the speed of communication or the speed of transmission or the speed of transmitting the messages from the source to the destination. So again, if I send you with a huge amount of speed, again, you will not be able to understand what I'm saying. So imagine if I'm talking to the class and I'm talking to a speed, I'm using a speed of the words that you cannot even cope with, you cannot even absorb, you cannot have time to consume. So in that case, we don't have efficient communication. So the flow control talks about controlling the speed of transmitting the messages with a very, very important objective. The important objective is not to overwhelm the destination, not to overwhelm the destination. Because if I speak very, very fast, the destination will not be able to cope with what I'm saying. Okay, so this is flow control, is to control the speed of communication to avoid overwhelming the destination or the receiver. Number two is what we call the access method. Access method here talks about not the speed, but the order. Okay, so logically and in general, we are not created to have a full duplex communication. بمعنى إني ما يعني it doesn't work that when I talk to someone, I talk while he is talking, and I listen while he is listening. It doesn't work this way. The communication has to go in order. First, I have to talk and he listens, okay? And after I finish, I have to somehow show the other person that I finished the sentence, I finished all my ideas. So I give the chance to the other person to, on one hand, make sure that he or she understood what I'm saying. On the other hand, make sure that this person also has the access or the chance to send or convey his or her ideas back to me. Okay, so this way we have efficient communication. So if we don't have access method, what will happen is that everyone will talk, you know, at the same time. So imagine if we have a class and everybody talks at the same time. So all the words are going to be like noise. No one will be able to understand anything. So without the access method, we have some interleaving words and interleaving sentences between the source and destination, and neither of them will be able to understand each other. So access method here talks about the order of the messages that goes from the source to the destination or from the destination to the source. So we have to have an access method. Number three, we have also a very important rule, which is called response timeout. Okay. And I'm sticking to the termination or to the terminology that's used in the material. So the material uses all these terms as they are: flow control, access method, and response timeout. For response timeout, the purpose or the meaning of the response timeout is that after conveying my sentences to you, when I send you the messages, I have to have a way to ensure that these messages have indeed been consumed by you and understood by you. Okay? So if I tell you, you know, the World Cup is happening in 2022 and we are very excited about this and that, and then I give you list of sentences and then I stop. In that case, what I'm expecting is that I need to have an acknowledgement from your side that indeed you have been following what I'm saying. And more often than not, this can happen in different ways. Like, for example, when I talk to a person, he would do like this. So he would do like this to tell me that, yeah, okay, yeah, I'm following you. So so that makes sense. So so that means to me that the communication is going on. There's no error. Okay, there's no problem happening. And whatever I'm saying is reaching to the other side. So what if I don't get that acknowledgement? If I don't get any kind of acknowledgement or a gesture from the destination that he or she is following what I'm saying? In that case, I will have to wait for a very important parameter called timeout. Let's say this timeout is like, you know, like 10 seconds. If within 10 seconds you did not send me an acknowledgement that indeed all my messages have reached to you, then I will consider that there was some kind of an error. Okay? So I will detect, the sender will detect that there was some kind of an error. And the error means that I have to do something about it, whether to again repeat all the sentences that I said, or I have to tell you that there was an error, I have to do anything about it, okay? So response timeout is the rule that governs how much time the sender should wait until the receiver sends acknowledgement that the messages or the communication is happening correctly. If after this timeout I did not get that acknowledgement, the sender will assume that there was some type of an error. Any questions there, Shabab, so far? Okay. Maheen Allah, you raise your hand. Do you have any question or you just keep your hand raised like this? Do you have a question? Okay. Taib, what about the message delivery options? So what are the rules within that category that we can have in any type of communication? Anyone can tell us, give us some idea? What are the rules of communication related to the message delivery options? Or under the category of message delivery options. Hani, تفضل. Hani Jafar. Yeah, this is the rule, the delivery options, yes. Which is Eva. Okay. So you have three delivery options. You're going in the right direction. So you have broadcast. Broadcast is all about what? Communicate to everyone. Bravo, Alec. Okay, so what else? اللي اسمها ايه؟ هي فيها كاست برضو ها؟ يونيكاست برافو عليك اوكي سو ذا ثيرد وان برضو فيها كاست برضو مالتي كاست برافو عليك هاني ماشي اوكي سو مالتي كاست از كونسرند وذ اي كوميونيكيتنج تو اي بقى It's not communicating to everyone, and it's not communicating to one particular person. But anything in between is multicast. So I'm communicating with a subgroup within the pool of people that I have. So for example, we can try. So here we have unicast. So by unicast here I mean that I say okay. So Hani. You did not deliver your homework on time. So in that case, I'm communicating with Hani specifically, and I have to use the physical name of the person. And we'll talk about what physical address means, what logical address means. But if I have a class, a big class like your class, and I want to communicate with one person only, this is what we call a unicast. So unicast, I have to specify the physical address of the person or the physical name, yani, of the person that I'm talking to, okay? Because I have many, many possibilities. The second rule is what we call broadcast. So by broadcast here, I mean that now my speech is not targeting a specific person. It's the entire class, like what I'm doing now. So I'm actually talking to the entire class, not specifically to a particular person or to a subgroup within the class. The multicast talks about something in between. So imagine if we have, like for example, subgroups within the class, for example, for a course project or something. So we have divided the class logically into six or seven subgroups. Okay, each group will work on a specific project. So in that case, I say group two, okay, you need to send me the proposal for your project by tonight, for example. So in that case, I'm specifying not by everyone and not specific person. So group two includes more than one person, okay? Normally more than one person. And that's what we mean by multicast. So these the message delivery options are very easy. So we have unicast, broadcast, and multicast, and we very frequently use one of these delivery options to deliver our messages to the other side of the communication. So whether it's a specific person or everyone or a subgroup of people. Right. So that's a quick briefing. So that's an example of how we can, you know, brief a specific topic, and the rest we'll spend it for activity two and activity three. So activity two here talks about the fact that we need to understand more what we mean by message structure. Okay, as we said, if two people are communicating together, they have to agree on a message structure, which is some grammatical rules that will restrict and dictate the structure of the sentences that we are using for communication. If we don't have messages well structured, then the messages for us will be just like, you know, noise and we corrupted messages and we cannot understand each other. So this activity here talks about the fact that Khaled is a person who is actually sending a letter to Amr, okay, to inform Amr that, you know, he's been in an Hajj trip and he enjoyed everything and enjoyed the holy places and so on. So that's a well-structured message. And usually the message is structured in two big or two big categories. One part would be this part, which is the envelope. Okay, so the envelope does not have message content. This is the message content itself. واضح كده؟ So this is the message content. Okay, and usually the message content will put it in an envelope. And that's a very, very important example, which exactly matches what we have in networks. So in networks, we cannot just, you know, get, for example, the web page or the video and just send it over the network like this. We cannot do that. If we do this, we don't specify who this file targeting, okay? We don't have any information about how to deliver the file or the web page to the other side. So these are very important information that has to come with the message content. And that's why communicating messages over the network has to have an overhead. Okay? We cannot just send the messages, the message content as it is. We have to send with it some, you know, envelope or some header or some metadata that will tell the network how to indeed deliver this message successfully. So that's a hint about how to solve that activity. So as you can see here, the dark blue fields here, okay, I hope you can, you know, distinguish that these are dark blue, these two fields and this field, okay, these are not part of the content of the message. These fields are required to tell the network, or in that case, to tell the mail system how to deliver that message to Amr, in that case, okay? So the fields in the middle here, they are represented, or they represent the message content, and even the message content in many cases, as we said, it has to be well-structured. I have to use different part of the structure of the message to indicate different things so that the when the letter reaches Amr, Amr can really understand what this message is all about. Okay? So the way that we go about these activities is that I will give you 2 minutes to go through the activity and try to solve it on your own. I tried at some point to again divide the class into rooms, and each room would have like a group or something. But this actually did not work efficiently, unfortunately. So, unfortunately, on using the online method that we have now, the best is just to give you some chance to go through that activity on your own and try to really go through that activity and guess what part of the message, okay, needs to be inserted in which location here, so that when I send this message across the network or across the mail system in that case, that we have a well-structured message and the destination can understand exactly what we're saying. Okay, so I'll give you 2 minutes to go through that activity, and please raise your hand once you have finished the activity. The people who raised their hands, are they done? Are they finished? سهلة واضحة. Okay. خلاص. Let's do it together. And just to let you know, I may actually ask someone to go through the activity and solve the entire activity, in which case this person can get the bonus, or we can solve it all together. Okay. So let's just Jassim Hamad. تفضل يا جاسم قول لنا الايه؟ قول لنا الانسر. So we start from the left with the destination location address. What is this? Okay, اللي هو ايه؟ This one. So the destination local address, or the destination location address, is where this letter will go. Okay, so that will tell us how to deliver the mail to the other side. ماشي. Sender location address. تفضل. تمام. تمام. The start of the message indicator. So we will talk about why do we need a start of a message indicator. That's very important. We will talk about it later. Why do we need a start message and an end of a message and so on. We'll talk about that. So now as an indicator for us that this is the beginning of the message content, this is the word dear, or sometimes we use hi, sometimes salamu alaikum, any kind of indication that this is the beginning of the message. And then the recipient identifier, Amr. Tamam? So this is the recipient. This is the one who was supposed to receive the message. ماشي. And then the message content, which is basically this part. صح? Tamam? That's easy. Okay. Khalid, tamam? That's the tricky one. أنا مش هديك البونص غير لما تقول لي. I'm just kidding. إيه what's أيوة. ما هو إحنا خلصنا كل حاجة. في إيه اللي ناقص دلوقتي؟ لا لا. ماشي هو ممكن I can بص شوف. أنا هقول لك على حاجة. لو كان ذا لايت بلو. So in that case. The end indicator would be part of the message content, which is in that case yours. But this field is in fact dark blue. What does that mean? This means that this is indeed part of the envelope. It's not part of the content. So what's missing in the envelope that we did not talk about? ده اللي هو الستامب بنقول ولا صح؟ اللي هو الستامب. A stamp for any mail message indicates that this message is really vetted and it's complete and it can indeed be sent. Okay, so again this field is dark blue, which means that this field is not part of the message content itself. If it's light blue, we could actually have a part of the structure here between the sender identifier and the end message indicator. We say here, مثلا, end content. Okay? In that case, this is part of the content of the message, not part of the envelope. Okay? The envelope is not part of the content. The envelope is used to describe how the message will be delivered. واضح? But it's not part of the message content itself. ماشي? So the reason that more correctly, again, to be absolutely correct, it's actually the stamp and not the word yours, is because this field is actually dark blue, which indicates that this is part of the envelope. It's not part of the content. That's the only trick. And I agree this is tricky, but خلينا أشوف جاسم حمد. تمام. جاسم. Okay, so this is the stamp. So that's a well-structured message that if I send this mail this way with this structure, we guarantee and we have a certain level of confidence that when this letter reaches Amr will be able to understand this message. We'll see that the message is targeting him based على recipient address, so he will open the letter and then he will take a look at the message content and he will understand the message efficiently and correctly. ماشي كده؟ طيب, the second activity number three here talks about the message timing and delivery options, which are the two other categories for the rules of communication that we talked about. And even if you didn't watch the video, okay, so what are these message timing and delivery options rules that we talked about? We talked about how many? We talked about how many of these rules اوكي بدر 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 اتفضل. لا هو احنا لا احنا اتكلمنا على الفيرست كاتيجوري when we talked about message structure, so we need the second and the third. اوكي so in the second category we talked about ايه اللي هو المسج تايمينج which includes اللي هو includes ايه بقى ايوه access method تمام ايه لا 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 message size is part of the rules for the message content it's not part of the rules for message timing and an order okay the message size has to do with the content not with the message timing and order so here we talked about response time out للاسف اجابتك مش كامله so far يا بدر طيب what about the message delivery options we talked about ايه unicast broadcast and multicast okay so the idea of this matching exercise is to try based on this definition to write down here the concept or the rule that we are talking about based on this definition so it's a simple again matching exercise that we have very frequently throughout the course so again I will give you يعني a few minutes 2 minutes ولا حاجة to go through this activity and then we can solve it together Yes. So the first one is a is controlling the speeds of the speed of transmission. This is a the speed of transmission. Controlling the speed of transmission. No, that's not correct. This is flow control, okay? So flow control is concerned with controlling the speed of communication. صح, dimension. Controlling the order and time of transmission. Access method, بالضبط. This has to do with who should talk when, okay? Who should talk when, type. Avoids overwhelming the receiver. Yeah, لا 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 لا. That's totally very far. That's very far. Then avoid overwhelming the receiver. Avoid overwhelming the receiver. So avoid overwhelming the receiver. واضح. To avoid that the receiver will not be able to cope with what I'm saying. Abdulaziz Rashid. Abdulaziz Rashid, تفضل. تفضل. Avoids overwhelming the receiver. Which one is this? Okay, fair enough. ماشي. احنا بنحاول يعني ايه نبوش يعني بنحاول نساعدك يعني. لا لا لا. Okay, so this is exactly يا شباب why we have these types of activities. Avoid overwhelming the receiver. That's actually flow control also. But the fact that you confine yourself to the fact that flow control is here, so this one should be different. No, I can use different definitions for the same thing. And that's exactly why we have these types of activities, to give us the ability to identify the tricks, the different tricks. As we said, the complete definition of the flow control is to control the speed of transmission with the objective of avoiding to overwhelm the receiver. Okay. Type. Avoid waiting for a reply forever. This is it. أي حد ممكن يجاوب. Response timeout. تمام. Response timeout. تمام. Controls who can access the medium when. Again, that's a access method. Yes. So who can access the medium when? Okay. So who will talk and who and the other one listens and who will listen and the other one talk and so on. Use for error recovery. That's a tricky one. That's a bonus question. response timeout. تمام. response timeout. طبعا the other three are for the delivery options, the message delivery options, which includes ايه بقى, the communicating to a subgroup. This is a multicast. Communicating with one specific computer, this is unicast. And communicating to an announcement. Announcement معناها ايه؟ Announcement معناها ان I'm talking to everyone. Okay, which is broadcast. So these are the rules of communication. The rules of communication is a very important topic, and it's very important to agree implicitly or explicitly between the source and the destination about these rules of communication before we start communicating. If we don't agree on the message structure, if we don't agree on the speed, if we don't agree on the message delivery options, then the communication will not happen efficiently and correctly. Okay? If I wait for you forever and you don't give me the acknowledgement that indeed you have absorbed what I'm saying, then you know I will consider that this is an error, and I will repeat what I'm saying again. So that's also not an efficient way of communication. Okay, so that's the